hope you can hear me, but I have a very loud voice, so you shouldn't have any problem. Never easy to start, but I'm presenting today basically a proof of concept. This is just a pilot study that we tested 2 years ago with some colleagues from the University of Cambridge and the Virtual Experience Company. And this is aimed basically at the preservation, virtual preservation of a palace in Tunis called Sarsayit. In countries affected by conflict, there are often contested narratives about the country's history and heritage. Because these narratives are strongly held, it is difficult to reach consensus between different groups about the accepted historical narrative of a country. In this country, it is crucial to equip students with tools to enable them to reflect on histories rather than history, and to think about their personal and community connections to their heritage rather than trying to teach an agreed historical narrative. The development of inquiry-based activities in virtual heritage environments may be a creative and accessible way to engage young learners with the richness of their heritage. The inquiry method aims to support students to inquire about their heritage using similar approaches to those used by professional historians. Such activities enable children to engage with the ideas autonomously within selected themes. So we decided basically to use this pedagogy, which has been tested also in North Africa, but especially here in the UK. Based on these premises, we developed an online project combining virtual reality and historical inquiry to engage young Tunisians with activities related to the rise of their nation in the context of their built heritage. The project, starting from the digital documentation of Sarsayit, the final residence of the, for the last Ottoman base, rulers of Tunisia, and was funded by the British Council Culture Protection Fund. In essence, Sarsayit is a microcosm of Tunisian history, combining both tangible and intangible evidence of the myriad aspects of this nation's history. The palace fell into disuse about 50 years ago, until the Rambourg Foundation made it accessible to local people through the exhibition Le Veille d'une Nation, which was attended by over 25,000 people in less than 2 months. The reemergence of the palace into public awareness provided an opportunity to build on the momentum that the exhibition had started and make this important monument available to the many Tunisians who cannot afford to visit Tunis and its major monuments, with the risk of exposing them to disaffection with an important aspect of their cultural heritage. We created a virtual experience of the palace using 360 panoramas, so it's not definitely high-tech, as you can see also from this. And you will find, I'm sorry, but I didn't, I forgot to give you the link, but if you want to find the experience and the activities, you need to click on sarsayit.net and you will find the webpage. So 360 panoramas, which provided portals to a range of educational missions, each focused around an inquiry question. The project's primary aim was to deliver the educational and advocacy content to a wide audience across the country with limited or diverse methods of access to the internet. And we felt that a webpage with panoramas was the easiest and most accessible way. It is important to state that we also avoided simply adopting a gamification approach. Our intention was to prioritize the pedagogical model of inquiry, building students' autonomy in their learning and enhancing the role of discussion. The design idea was to present contents that appear different from the children's everyday reality, which might seem so foreign at first, and ask them to make connections between these apparent uncanny objects or concepts and their culture and everyday life. This approach has its foundations within the theory of the uncanny, taken from Freud, and conceptualized by designer James Auger. By beginning with the idea of the uncanny, inquiry approaches enable students to relate aspects of their daily life to the uncanny elements presented by some of the features of the palace and elements of the educational missions. Children should be able to explore the idea of hybridity and the concept of culture as heterochrony, a series of layers which add up, as per Foucault. We developed the missions as a co-design and assessment project based on formative consultation with various stakeholders to build our understanding of Tunisian heritage, aims at selecting the inquiry questions and relating missions for the web portal. a first stage of assessment with schools, and then a summative assessment with one school and members of the National Institute of Patrimony to assess content infrastructure development and the quality and level of engagement of the proposed activities. A qualitative approach to our research was an optimal way to gather data for the critical design and implementation of the project. Engaging in a qualitative approach provides enhanced opportunities for detailed understanding of users' engagement and learning, allowing us to build understanding of the responses from the ground up, rather than superimposing our expectations through the use of a survey. The formative consultation aimed at to define the inquiry questions and designs of the missions, including in-depth interviews and discussions with historians, teachers, staff members of the National Institute of Patrimony, surviving members of the family of the base, and employees of the Rambourg Foundation who'd been involved with the exhibition Le Veille d'une Nation. In developing learning content, we wanted to the participants to have an active role, and as such, we had to build in multiple review points. Our aim was to engage, to agree to on five or six broad themes that would become the main missions of the virtual application. This stage of the design was particularly complex, as the very nature of the online activities required us to reduce the complexity of Tunisian history and heritage to a small selection of contents presented in a language that would be engaging for students. During our interviews, we observed that different parties had different views about the key aspects of heritage to explore. Some were reticent about activities focused on the role of women, for instance, on the post-Arab Spring era and on the era of Bourguiba. After consultation with some of our Tunisian collaborators, we decided to avoid engaging with more recent history. It was our aim to enable children to think without having such thinking masked by strongly held beliefs. The first stage of assessment consisted of focus groups with teachers, head teachers, and selected students of one state and two private schools, providing both primary and secondary education in Tunis. Our initial idea was that inquiry activities would be too distinct from normal classroom activity, and that teachers would not see value in them, preferring instead to teach content rather than let children build ideas in relation to their heritage. Therefore, we designed first drafts of five learning activities based on five concepts of historical thinking and the following aspects of cultural heritage: architecture, ceramics, food, language, and the base. We then tried to establish subject knowledge of teachers and students about the five proposed themes and what support material teachers needed to build their own knowledge, and pedagogical knowledge of teachers, with particular attention to the inquiry method, of course. Finally, we talked through the first two missions activities with teachers and students and asked them to give opinions on how they would work, both for children at home and in class. Teachers and students could interact with their 3D panoramas while discussing content with us. One student highlighted the importance of the virtual experience, stating, "During our visit to Ksar Said for Le Veille d'une Nation, they said we couldn't take photos, so we could easily forget the details of the palace. With these, the virtual tour, we can revisit these details." So it's interesting. Feedback on the activities was very positive. We understood that teachers' knowledge of their own heritage was in some places limited, and that pedagogical understanding differed very much between schools, with the international schools having a more ingrained tradition of involving students in their own learning. The approach to learning through inquiry was one which all teachers valued, but may not have found easy to implement. This first stage of assessment allowed us to refine our support materials. We decided to include briefs on the historical concept in the webpage as professional development materials and avoided content briefs, which could lead teachers to teach facts rather than engaging students in their own learning. Our summative assessment was a final trial of activities in one of the three schools. We found that activities which required students to hunt the virtual palace for evidence were most popular and engaging, and the benefits of setting the learning activities within the virtual model were clear in fostering the engagement of students, even though with the panoramas there was a limit to the sophistication of the activities. We also tried priming students with knowledge before they engaged in the activities. This undermined the activities in the students' eyes and vindicated our decision to remove information briefing documents from the website. This meant that all learning and information could only be acquired by engagement with the learning activities. Finally, we asked several summary questions to understand students' perception of the activities and the extent of their learning. And this is what basically the main themes we were able to gather. But without going into details, it will suffice to say that all students and their teachers agree that the activities enable them to critically reflect on their cultural heritage. We observed the instances of dialogue, and multiple students contributed to that dialogue, questioning themselves and each other. Now, some thoughts to conclude this paper, and I hope they will enhance some discussion later. As mentioned before, the selection of effective technologies and design of the online platform and its associated contents was a complex, non-linear process. It required formal and informal meetings, focus groups, and interviews with various stakeholders, as well as an important process of mediation between the different stakeholders involved in the co-creation of contents. I feel, and I take responsibility for this statement, that our mediation process was not a complete success, because in the ideal world, the mediation happens when all parties involved sit in a room and discuss the contents together, trying to reach a final consensus. For various reasons, which I will be happy to discuss later, the interviews were individual, and our parties never sat together in a room, basically. What worked really well instead was that the two-stage evaluation of contents and activities allowed us to first evaluating with multiple schools and then evaluating pre-final versions in more depth, which enable us to ratify our learning strategies and then refine the activities themselves. With regard to the summative assessment, in future projects we'll trial activities first with teachers to iron out difficulties before taking them to trial with students. It would also be critical to involve students at an earlier stage in the co-creation of contents, but also in the selection of the virtual experience. For this purpose, our future research will aim to expand this study by developing a more structured program with schools in Tunisia aimed at testing similar activities using different technologies to see which technology might better enhance the learning experience. And here, I conclude. Thank you.
Thank you.